So, distinguished colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon to all of you and very, very welcome to the World Food Forum and in particular to this session, first session of the afternoon, dedicated to research and innovation for boosting European sustainable food and nutrition security and safety and agri-food business. I'm Fabio Fava from the School of Engineering of University of Bologna. I'm very, very pleased, very honored to chair this session and to welcome you this afternoon. As it was clearly mentioned this morning, a number of challenges and are currently affecting the food security and safety also in Europe, but in particular in many areas, several areas of our planet. There are global challenges, and Europe has to do its best, has to contribute to face them in the proper way. Among the major needs, there are the increase of quantity and quality of biomass, the raw materials that we are currently producing from agriculture, livestock, fishery, aquaculture. And at the same time, we have to do it by reducing the impact that we apply on the environment. So by increasing the environmental sustainability and the resilience of our biomass towards especially climate change. We have to also identify new agricultural landscapes. We have to valorize in a more efficient way the local biodiversity, and we have to look at new alternative resources of proteins, nutrients. On the other hand, we have to minimize the raw material losses, the food wastages that we are producing all along the food chain. We have to implement more efficient processing for producing more food and less byproducts and waste. We have to develop smarter packaging, smarter supply and distribution chain logistics. And we also have to work or start working on the unavoidable byproducts that we are producing. We have to valorize this, as it was clearly mentioned this morning, to use this for making ingredients in new food products. We have to also work in order to improve food safety and quality, but in particular the availability of healthy, safe and nutritional improved foods. But this is not enough. We also have to work for promoting healthy diets via science-based, knowledge-based information education. We also have to educate on the nexus that there is in between diet, lifestyle, and health. These are only some of the priorities. Research and innovation can surely contribute to address such challenges and needs and developing solutions to increase productivity, sustainability, and safety at all stages of the food chain, from the primary production to the formulation of safe and healthy diets. And research and innovation can also provide the knowledge, as I mentioned before to you, that can allow us to underpin good, robust policy in the sector. Europe is a key actor in this landscape for several reasons, for geopolitical reasons, but also for the prominence of its agri-food sector, which is now counting on a turnover of about 1.5 trillion of euros per year, and also about 14 million of employees. These numbers are those that you can have if you are combining agri-food sector with the food industry, the transformation towards food. So, very important numbers. European community is also investing money on research and innovation. The Horizon 2020 put 3.8 billion euros for the 7 years for sustaining bioeconomy in Europe. Agri-food sector is a prominent piece of bioeconomy of European bioeconomy. So it's also investing money. European Union is also building up a new medium-term research innovation agenda for a more productive, sustainable agri-food sector for the future. Also, it's also working on the bioeconomy strategy that was developed in 2012. Now we are working on the new strategy. So there are a lot of things ongoing, and the idea of this session, the major objective of this session, is to make an update on this, on the status of this kind of work, of these new agendas that are under development by in Europe, European Commission in particular. So the EU actions for soil protection, sustainable production, nutrition security, and in particular safety, and what Europe is doing for a better integration of the actors which are working along the value chain, in particular through the new call for a knowledge innovation community. And then also the potential risks and opportunity for the European agri-food sector offered by the international markets will be one of the issues, one of the topics of this session. So we will do this thanks to the kind and effective cooperation of our speakers, prominent speakers. You can see them already. One of the speakers that we have to have is in the program is Dr. Iman Butt, Deputy Head of Unit for DG Agriculture Rural Development at the European Commission. Unfortunately, he couldn't fly because they canceled the flight. We tried to reschedule the flight, but we couldn't succeed on this. He couldn't join us. So I asked in agreement with Iman and also the European Commission, I asked to my friend Chris Patterman to deliver the talk that Dr. Butt prepared for us. And Chris Patterman will be the first expert involved in this this afternoon session. As you know very well, Chris Patterman is a former director for bioeconomy at the European Commission, and it is currently the advisor, one of the prominent advisors of the German government for bioeconomy related topics. So it's a very interesting. Thank you once again, Chris, for this kind of availability. The second expert is Dr. Luca Montanarella, senior expert, Land Resources Management, Joint Research Center, European Commission. He is deeply involved in the setup of the European Thematic Strategy for Soil Protection. Is working in a number of other working groups and behind different policies on the soil protection. Is also member of a new group, Global Soil Partnership Initiative at FAO. And then Dr. Stefano Fontana will continue. He is at the unit, Partnerships Management, European Institute of Innovation and Technology. He is the person in charge for the open calls for the two new knowledge innovation community. One is on food, another one on related, very, very interesting and related areas. And then we have Dr. Bernhard Huld, Executive Director of European Food Safety Authority, EFSA. He is a veterinarian by training, but is mostly a prominent expert in the risk assessment in the food sector. Finally, but not least, Professor Patrizio Bianchi, Regional Minister for European Political Development, School, University, Research and Work at the Emilia-Romagna Region. He is the former rector of University of Ferrara, but here this afternoon is in particular a prominent professor in applied economics. So, that is the few words that I thought to use for introducing this afternoon session. And then I leave the floor to Chris Patterman as a first expert. If you reach me here, you can go through the presentation. I really thank you once again because you got the presentation this morning.
That's right.
Thanks a lot. So please continue. Yes, I think so.
Okay.
You can see. Thank you.
Pleasure. Well, good afternoon and buongiorno a tutti.
I was a little flabbergasted to be quite open this morning, but you know, I'm the former director in the European Commission. I was immediately prepared to jump in for my colleagues who, for a variety of reasons, couldn't come today. But please forgive me if not everything which I tell you is 100%, and in one or two or three other cases I'll say, no, this is something like that, or this is my personal view, just to round it up, etc. So research and innovation, I'm not giving you a generic talk about research and innovation in the European Union, that then we would miss the wonderful dinner tonight. I simply would like to draw some focus on some essentials for our topics, and then also draw some conclusions. And I'm also not going to bore you on the gaps in the agriculture knowledge base, because you know that was discussed at length today, ranging from agroforestry to hybrid seeds, and also the digitalization revolution in the area of the agriculture, plus also the immense impact, vice versa, on global climate change, on agriculture, and on food. And for that reason, I will very much focus on the tandem, on the research methodologies and also the research activities plus, and that is the essential, the innovation. Because innovation is rather, I would say, recent in the European Commission. Just a few years ago, it was the European Innovation, the system which was brought up, etc. And some people thought that that would be just one of these hypes of the Commission. Each year they bring up something new, etc. But it's not the case. It's really getting a lot of very practical steps and a lot of very practical measures to be undertaken, and also money to be put aside for that. So on research, I'm not going to talk to you very much, because that is being very well documented in the call for proposals between DG Agri and my former Director General RTDI. But I want to talk to you more about the innovation, and here at the basis, practices. Everybody knows about best practices. What we normally know very little is, what is the basis for these practices? And can we make it accountable? Is it science and evidence-based so that we can learn from it, or is it just a repetition? And for that reason, there are a lot of projects, there are a lot of activities within DG Agri in very close cooperation with the other Directorate Generals in order to go ahead with that, because this is the deficit of Europe, the innovative implementation. I need not to tell you why, you all know about that, but we really have to take that serious. We have brilliant ideas, my home country, Germany, the country of ideas, but when it comes to the question to implement, buff. Then you're standing there and the others are making the money, and the others are really building up the machines, building up the factories, and really gaining momentum, etc. So what is the Commission doing in these farming practices? Before I come to that, just an agriculture research rundown here, on which there is one point where I want to make a special point of that. From my point of view, and that is not here on the slide, what is important in the agriculture research, which the Commission is now practicing, that you have much more interfaces being looked at than before. So the so-called systemic or systematic approach is extremely important, so that you look on what are the food people doing, what are the digital people doing, what are the mobile people doing, what about the education, and what about other technologies who might be very helpful. That is something which still agriculture, conventional agriculture research, has its problems to do. But we are on a very, very good way, and it differs from one region to the others, I would say. In this context, I simply want to recall you one point. When I was director in the Commission, I was in DG RTD responsible for DG Agri. I was responsible for agriculture research. Don't forget, and that was reality, for more than 7 years, there had been not a single cent spent in Europe in the framework programs on agriculture research. There was just in the priority 8, 100 million euros for policy research. The reason was very simple, BSE. BSE, BSE, BSE. And then in 2004, with the seventh framework program, when we invented the bioeconomy, the agriculture research came back. And today it's DG Agri who wants to take DG, all the research activities and demonstration back, and they have been quite successful. It also shows very much in one very interesting gremium, and that is the Standing Committee on Agriculture Research. You know, it is a wonderful example to show to you how far people have already thought 50 years ago. When we established the Common Agriculture Policy, the question came up in the 70s, what are we doing with agriculture research? And the idea at that time was, wow, we are probably not able to have a common research policy as such in Europe. But people had the feeling, wow, when we are having a common agriculture policy, we need to have a kind of corresponding research activity. And that's why they invented, as the first comitology committee in the European Union, the Standing Committee on Agricultural Research, which was a mixtum. It was chaired by the Commission, but all the member states were there, and they had a lot of decision power at that time. Now, in the course of the years, this Standing Committee on Agricultural Research started to fade away. It was in a sleeping mode, if I may say so. And when I started in 2003, when I got this new job in biotechnology, food, agriculture, etc., DG Agri offered me to take over the Standing Committee on Agriculture Research, and it's still there. So that is very interesting to show, you know, the dynamism in this area. You know, whenever something is successful and you get a lot of money, and today agriculture is in everybody's mouth, today it's in everybody's mind, not necessarily in the same support, etc. If it's in your mind and it's in your eyes, etc. So then you are again interested in something, but if it's running badly, you know, then you get rid of that. Now let's have the next point, what the topics of the research are: resources management, healthier plants and animals, ecological approaches. There is one point which I want to draw your attention to, and that is a small criticism from my point of view towards this morning. You have forgotten livestock. And in the next round, you really should do a little more about that. Almost 50% of the value chain in agriculture is livestock oriented, but we were talking practically 100% today about plants, seeds, etc. Please be more round, if I may say so, and please do not underestimate, also for Europe, the importance of the livestock. So I wanted to make that point. And the same applies, if I may also just add here a personal remark to this list. We always talk, when we talk about agriculture, about rural areas. I understand that, and it's okay. But please don't forget the tremendous tendency towards megacities, urban harvesting, or if you have a lot of new technologies which are just being prepared at the Grüne Woche in Berlin or at Sial in Paris, you know, if you are missing that point for the agriculture people, you are going to very strongly complain about it and you will regret it, because the trend all over the world is clearly within the next 20 to 30 years that there are more and more people moving over to mega cities with their own rights, with their own demands, with their own laws, with their own technologies, with their own agendas, etc. And that does not mean that I'm going to belittle the importance of rural growth and to support it. But you need to complement it as well with parallel activities to make it interesting for the farmers also to deal with that in a dialogue with the citizen, if I may say so. The next point is very interesting as well, and this is the kind of core of my messages. The Commission is at this moment preparing a new strategy on Agriculture Plus, if I may say so. And it is very important that there are three new, if I may say so, new, because they had never been put in that exposed way before, new cross-cutting activities. The first one I mentioned already a few minutes ago, go away from pinpointing or singling out problems, go more to the system-based approaches and look also on converging technologies. And the second point is extremely important. We need to talk about agriculture 4.0. We need to do that for a variety of reasons. It's not only because of agriculture machines, the so-called net, you know, that you have satellite connections, that you have better fertilizing doses, etc. It's also the influence of the internet by the people who are in blocks for new food and new food products in the dialogue which is necessary with the farmers' union. And that is something which I find at this moment the farmers' union are not prepared. And also on the other side of the net users, there is no preparedness to enter into a dialogue. So that is something very important, you know, within the digitalization world, you know, which we should really look at it, also accompany it with research and innovative activities. And that very well fits into the socio-economic, in the socio-economic research. In the slides which you will get, there is a link towards this draft strategy of the innovation and research strategy of the union in agriculture, which was already to some extent proposed on the, I think it was 26th and 27th of January in Brussels in a new conference. Now, innovation. There's a lot of talk about it, and I'm not going to give you a course about the let me say, generalities of innovation. But there was one point which I think Hugo de Vries made very clear this morning, and that is we have to get used in our minds, in research, and also in the preparedness to act, that innovation is not at all linear. So our logical course, our logical thinking, you know, is not the right one to use, and we have to get used to that. That's not easy, in particular for researchers who are used to have the logic from here to here, you know, it is not easy that you are going to do that. And so I found Hugo de Vries' statement very, very interesting about this middle pathway, you know, and so we should think about that. And the other point is the interactivity, or the new buzzword for it is connectivity, which is extremely important. In the bioeconomy, we are doing it around the expression of the value chain with a different diversity of stakeholders, etc., that you need to have a two-ways dialogue with a high variety of different stakeholders on which you usually don't think about, so that you enter in so-called unusual alliances. And that is extremely important, and that is a kind of mind changing, which is much more necessary, which you can't just instruct from above. Where do the farmers get their new ideas? And here something is indeed forgotten, and that is the blogs. If you go today into the internet, you have hundreds of blogs all over the world on new food. There's practically each week a new food product arriving, you know, and you have very interesting crossovers between cheesecake and brownies, and then you have the soup revolution, you know, have now the cauliflower and also green flour, you know, chips made up. And these hypes, if you may say so, are very quickly transformed into very strong movements with hundreds and thousands of so-called urban citizens who buy it. And then there's all of a sudden a market, and research and science is not accompanying it. And there's also a very interesting trend on the internet, I think you all know that, that half of them, you know, are very strongly looking and loving very unhealthy food. It has become a sport to have very high calorie food, etc. And no one is saying anything against it. Research is simply not coping with it. So I think we really, really have to put these new, if I may say so, new challenges in front of food research and in front also of the agriculture research. The traditional extension services, I personally think, are no more really the right tool. They have to be adopted. They have to be adapted very quickly to these new tools in the internet, where in particular younger people are very quickly reacting. And here, I think it is very, very important that advisors are helping, that we have, and that's now my last point, that we have in the innovative projects, in the operational groups and so-called multi-actor projects, which the Commission is funding in the EIP's pilot projects, that we also have included users on the internet, you know, so that this is being studied, that this is being really coped with, so that the farmers, the fishermen, and the forest owners, the three Fs, really get advice and help how to deal in our modern world. I'm very sorry that I had to jump in. These were a few remarks, and I tried to do my best to give you, instead of my colleagues, not replacing them, a former director of the Commission, retired, can never replace an active Commission member, so that I took over some of his ideas and that I presented them to you, and I wish you a very good afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Christian, very much for everything. Nice talk, very effective. Thanks to also Dr. Booth for the PPT, the presentation that he delivered. He also apologized deeply with all of us for its inability to be here this afternoon. So we will continue now with Dr. Montanarella. So Luca, please. We move to soil protection, exploitation, etc. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fabio, for the introduction, and good afternoon to everybody. You will have to stand a second presentation by somebody from the European Commission. I'm working in a different service. I'm working in the DG Joint Research Center. For the ones who are not familiar with the Joint Research Center, it's the the science policy interface of the Commission. The Commission has its in-house science and technology service, and my job is essentially dealing there with soil related issues. And so my talk to you, which will be very short, will be about where food begins, simply because more than 90% of all our food starts from the soil. And so I thought that maybe it's of interest to you to learn a little bit more about the importance of soils, also because we are just coming out of the experience of the United Nations International Year of Soils. You may know that 2015 was declared by the United Nations the International Year of Soils. We had there 1 year of events trying to explain to everybody in the world why soils are important for food security and also for other reasons. And so I will base a little bit my presentation on that experience and we'll try a little bit to bring you the message that soils are important if you want to talk about food security. Now, we'll talk about soils, not about land. I always have to explain a little bit before I start talking the difference, simply because most of us are used to look to landscapes and are not aware very often that there is something happening below ground which is quite relevant to our job. It's very important to keep in mind that if you dig a hole, you will discover a complete new world. And this is this world that allows the crops actually to produce what we eat every day on our dishes. So it's important that we keep somehow the perception that there is a below ground dimension that we need to respect, we need to know, we need to study, we need to have some knowledge about. So it's this message that I wanted to convey to you, also in conjunction with the fact that soils are very different. Different parts of the world have different types of soils, and different types of soils have different properties. And one thing that we should keep in mind is that the amount of soils on this planet is limited, is fixed, and it's not easy to expand unless we go on a different planet, and that the soils that are actually suitable for agricultural production are relatively limited. First of all, you need to keep in mind that many areas, you see them here, where there is no soil. All the areas covered by inland waters, covered by permanent ice, like Antarctica, like Greenland. Then you have areas which are simply too high in altitude. These are all the mountain areas which are usually not suitable for agricultural production. Then you have areas which are simply too cold, areas where there is type of soils which are permanently frozen, for example, exposed to permafrost, and which are not suitable for agricultural production. Then there are areas which are too hot, simply because the temperatures there would not allow you to do easily agricultural activities. Then there are areas, of course, that are too dry, areas that are covered by soils which are much too in tropical areas, soils which are saline, soils which are covered by permanent forests, soils which are in saline and or in tropical areas. And at the end, I would like to speed up a little bit, otherwise we don't have enough time. We will have the amount of soils that are currently the ones that are fertile and that can be used without major technology input. So these are the fertile soil bases that we have, which is roughly between, let's say, around 13 to 18% of the total land area. So this is the basis on which the food production is based currently on the planet. This is very important to be known because there are many that advocate that there is no limitation in the soils that we can cultivate. This is true, of course, you can cultivate everywhere in the world if you put enough technology. There have been projects to cultivate in the middle of the Sahara. You can cultivate everywhere if you have enough technology. But we are talking here about sustainability of these type of systems. So what does it mean? It means that roughly we have a fairly basis, stable agricultural area, which is roughly not expanding. It's around 1.6 billion hectares that are under cultivation. As you see over the years, it didn't really grow. What is growing is essentially the blue area. The blue area is the area under irrigation. But what is steadily growing, and we also learned it this morning with the presentation by Professor Rajaram, what is steadily growing is the population. This means that we have a decreasing amount per person of surface. Currently, we are around 0.2 hectares per person that is available for producing the food that we consume. This means that each of us should live of 0.2 hectares, meaning 2,000 square meters. So if you have a garden and you have some agricultural experience, you will realize that this is not easy. There are many families that do this. We learned it also this morning. If you look to all the smallholder family farming systems in some parts of the world that live on surfaces which are below 1 hectare, there are people who can live on very small surfaces, but many of us are consuming much more than 0.2 hectares. And this implies that there is somebody else that must live with less surface of fertile soils. I will come back to this at the end of my presentation. So how to cope with this? Well, the solution is usually having a better technology. Over a series of green revolutions, we have been able to intensify massively per hectare production. Intensification has been the main key to achieve enough production to feed all of us on this planet. So agricultural production has been constantly increasing per hectare, while, as I said, the overall cropland has been fairly stable over the last 50 years. So where is this intensification happening? Not everywhere we have the same type of intensification. There are areas in the world where intensification has been already very massively implemented. These are the areas which are less dark on this map. The darker areas in the map are the areas which have still a huge potential for further intensification of agricultural production. So areas where the potential of the soils could be higher than the current production. This is the areas actually where we should invest if we want to bring up the production everywhere on the same level. So it's not that simple, because on top of all that, we have a number of activities, of human activities, that limit soil production and limit soil fertility. A number of human-induced soil degradation processes that have been well recognized by the European Commission when we prepared the EU's soil thematic strategy. And these are these processes that I will not go into detail, like soil erosion, soil contamination, loss of soil organic carbon, soil compaction, soil sealing. There are plenty of them that have a negative impact on the productivity of global soil resources. Now, There's been a recent assessment, by the way, it was the major output of the Intergovernmental Technical Panel on Soils that I'm chairing, presented last year in the World Soil Day, which made a global assessment, the first global assessment of the status of world soil resources. You can download it from the Global Soil Partnership website. And that's 600 and more pages of intergovernmental assessment, gives you an overview of the status of these various threats, so the various problems on soils in different parts of the world. I don't go into detail because absolutely we would not have the time, but what I want to say is that there are very serious soil degradation processes ongoing in most parts of the world, and that we should do something about it because, as I said, soils are a non-renewable resource and are the basis of most of our food production. Many people react, this is not my business, because there has been an argumentation saying soils don't move. So why should I care about the soils of another country if I'm anyway living in my country? Well, you may be surprised, but we are all living in Europe, particularly of the soils which are somewhere else. This is a very interesting study about virtual soil imports by the European Union. These are these surfaces in hectares of soils that we virtually import. This means the transformation of the imported goods translated into the surface that was used to produce this. This means that we live in Europe on soils that are somewhere else. And this makes, of course, for the European Commission, this a quite crucial issue to somehow globally address the issue of soil degradation and globally address the issue of how to sustainable use this not renewable resource, which is the basis of our food production. And that comes to my conclusion. That's why we have invested as European Commission a lot in launching global processes that may protect soils for future generations. One of the main initiatives that we initiated in 2011 was to bring together all countries of the world around one table, one discussion on a global soil resource, sustainable resource management, that is essentially the Global Soil Partnership. This, by the way, released the revised World Soil Charter, which is a charter, non-binding, of course, but signed by all countries in the world, that advocates sustainable soil management. We also very intensively tried to insert the issue of sustainability of soil resource management into the SDG debate, in the Sustainable Development Goals debate. You may find that several of the Sustainable Development Goals explicitly address the need to protect global soil resources. And so if we want to live in a planet of 9 billion people, as we heard also this morning, probably an effort to protect this basic resource is needed, and I hope that also this forum can contribute to this debate. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Luca. We will continue with Stefano Fontana. Now the topic is how to boost cooperation between the different actors, in particular education, research and business, for making new innovation or innovation in the food industry or in the food agri-food sector. Thank you. So please, Stefano, continue.
Okay, thank you for inviting me here. What is the European Institute of Innovation and Technology, first of all? Can you hear me? Yeah, okay. From this side, we can hear less, so we don't know if you can hear finally, or maybe. So the EIT, it's an agency that has been created by European Union in order to boost innovation in Europe. And the idea is that the innovation is boosted by creating some ecosystem, but nothing to do with ecology, so models, in which education actor, research actor, and business actor are together in a partnership in order to increase the market productivity of a certain societal challenge, and I will go more in detail about that, in a specific sector, so, and in order also to create a new entrepreneurial culture, so also to create students that studying their own field will also acquire a knowledge of being the future entrepreneur. So this is in few words what we are doing, and in doing so, we have some specific societal challenges. At the moment, we call this partnership KICS, Knowledge Innovation Communities. We have five of them running: energy, climate change, that has also some relevance for your field as well. We have digital, that is transversal, as has been also said from the previous speaker. And we have actually one about health, that again could be connected some way with food. And we have one on raw materials. And the good coincidence is that we have just launched a call for proposal for two new KICS, of which one of the two is related to food for future. So basically here I will just present you what is the call for proposal. The call for projects. These projects, a difference of what is normally done in the European Commission Horizon 2020, even if we are part of Horizon 2020 itself, the difference is these are very long-term projects. So we ask for a strategic agenda of 15 years. So our project lasts 15 years. And when they are at regime, their budget could be around 100 million per year. So this is quite a difference respect to other programs of the European Commission. So in respect to what is the call related to food, even if you may be interested also in the call for advanced manufacturing, that can also be related to food production. But in the case of food, what we are interested is in having a proposal for a knowledge innovation community, a KIC, that is related to the whole supply chain of food. So from resources to consumer. So we have to take into account what is the consumer behavior and attitude, the potential of the new business. So we don't create the market for specific product, we bring the market inside the consortium. We want to reduce the waste, promote better nutrition, and with the new innovation technology. At the same time, we also create students that will become the new resources for the future in the food sector. And in order to do this, we also have a good example for the previous KICS that are up and running. We bring in those consortium venture capitalists, so we mobilize investment. We have a long-term commitment. In the previous KICS, we have very large companies. I can mention a couple, Philips, Siemens. We have a quite important university. We have University of Bologna, Imperial College, KTH. And we have a very important also research center, like, for example, Fraunhofer Institute and so on, in all around Europe. We try, so for food again, to influence the industry and to focus more on the consumer part, to overcome the fragmentation that is in the sector. A typical KIC that is up and running contains up to 300 or 400 different actors that are members of the consortium, coming from the three sides of the knowledge triangle, so education, research, and business. And then we try to have also a multidisciplinary or transdisciplinary approach. The call timeline, we are in the middle of this graph, so the call has been launched, and the deadline, if there is anyone in the room that want to apply, is the 14th of July. So that's the last moment in which you and another 49 of your friends could form a consortium to come, because the consortium will be limited to 50 entities in this initial phase. There will be 1 year running as a setup phase of the final KIC, and then the consortium could grow. And it grows steadily. We have very good examples from the other KICs that are running. If we have a small look at the central part, so as soon as the proposal has been given to us, I mean after the deadline, then we check if all the criteria of eligibility has been respected. We have a panel of international experts that will judge the proposals, and then we have all the proposals that pass certain thresholds of marks will go to a hearing with our own governing boards. So I already said that there will be a panel of experts. These are independent. There are six. Basically, there is one expert more related to education, one more to innovation, and one more to business, and plus other experts, but all obviously related to the field of the food supply chain, in the case of the food cake. The eligibility and admissibility criteria, just very fast. The minimum set that we want to have is that there could be three independent organizations from three different EU states. Two-thirds of the whole consortium should be in the EU member states. That means that could be also somewhere else. So if there is a good justification, why not USA, Japan, China, Switzerland. There should be at least one academia and one private company in the consortium. And the maximum as a starting point should be 50 partners. The partners will be analyzed. The one of you that are familiar with the framework program 7 or Horizon 2020 will recognize similar requirements. So there will be a financial capacity assessment. It will be reasonable for us to give an initial dotation for 1 year or 4 million, having some assurance that this money will not be lost. And then there is also an operational capacity criteria. So it will be good if in general the partnership and in particular the coordinator of this initial phase will have some experience in coordinating similar projects, or at least one of the three sides of the knowledge triangle, and some knowledge of the European Union financial procedures will help. That could be of some difficulty for some of us that know them. There should also be an interim management team, because when the CIC will be up and running, it will have a very large degree of autonomy. So we will not impose any direction to the policy that the CIC has to develop. The CIC will also develop his own strategy for the food sector. Will not be imposed by us as a European body. So they will be also independent in this sense. And in order to help this setup, the CIC will have a setup that is business-like. So there will be a chief executive officer, a chief operational officer, and chief financial officer. And this management has to be, at least in an interim way, already being set up at the level of the proposal. I will go fast here. After the first evaluation, there will be a hearing. So the governing board of the EIT, that is independent from the EIT, is composed by very high level member of innovation, education, and business all around Europe. We'll also have a hearing with the different proposals that arrive to this stage. And at that point, in November, we will launch the initial phase of the CIC Food and the CIC Advanced Manufacturing. So these two new CIC will be added to the five that are up and running. The proposal structure, I would just maybe suggest you, if you are interested in this, to go on to the call site and have a look. There will be different parts. but I will not enter too much in detail to that. There are some limitation in writing a proposal, not exceeding a number of pages, but in particular not exceeding the number of the participants to the consortium. So we want to have only 50 partners, but they have to be really committed. So this is why there is a limitation. We have gained this number through the experience with the former KICS. So if you want to have more information, you can ask. There is a contact page, and we will be happy to answer to any question that you have related to this. Plus, you will probably have some question now, and I will be here to answer and somewhere around. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We continue with Bernhard Hult, and now we move to the food safety issues and what we need for the modern area, for the changing society. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the introduction and welcome also from my side. As we are based here in Parma, it's a special honor to be here and to contribute to the World Food Forum with a bit of a different view on innovation and research, obviously coming from a risk assessment and a safety perspective. Just to start with the picture, how research, risk assessment and food safety are linked in Europe, you can see that on a European base, that research is organized, funded, as we have seen, by RTD, is done by JRC, DG Agri has now its part, EID, as we have seen now, is funding, and obviously the member states are doing a lot. They are creating the data, the knowledge, the methodologies we need in the risk assessment business, EFSA, again, together with risk assessment organizations in the member states. And then this is translated by risk managers on the European level, but also on member states level, in food legislation, in standards, in maximum residue limits, in whatever, food legislation. And this is then enforced and implemented by the member states and also controlled again on a European level by the Food and Veterinary Office of the Commission. So this is the background where we, EFSA, you can see, play a certain role. We are not producing primary data on our own. We are using data that is produced by others. It's kind of a meta science that we use to produce scientific opinions for the risk managers. What we see, and it's kind of a no-brainer to say it, is with globalization, with the globalization, the movement of goods, of animals, of people, we also globalize hazards. And with innovation that was mentioned so often today, there's not only a creation of value, of added value, new products, new processes, obviously there are also new risks created. And industrialization as a term for environmental pollution and effects we see in the food chain all together create new hazards, and these new hazards meet a society that wants to be more protected. So we have a double fold challenge here. On the one hand, new hazards, on the other hand, maybe especially in Europe, but not only in Europe, a society that wants to be more and more protected. And in this tension, risk assessment takes place. And I just want to show some examples of what challenges we face. Lack of data could sound strange, because we're always talking about big data and we can use the big data in a more proficient way. But just to give you one example, when EFSA concluded on the safety assessment of bisphenol A, and a chemical that is used in packaging material in food containers, we could not finalize the assessment because there's a lack of data. So we have to wait for the outcome of a United States National Toxicology Program study And only then, when they will have finalized their study in 2017, we will hopefully have new data to finalize the assessment of bisphenol A, which means risk assessment suffers from lack of data. Chemical mixtures is something I just wanted to mention briefly, the combined exposure to multiple chemicals, and also scientifically an extremely difficult topic. We try and we do this together with member states to, for example, in pesticides now, to have combined assessment groups, because as humans, we are not exposed to one chemical, obviously, we are exposed to a mixture of chemicals, which in risk assessment is not an easy way forward. One topic where we need more research is alternatives to animal testing. In silico methods to predict toxicology or toxicity without doing animal tests, looking at the structure of molecules and try to predict the effect that these molecules could have on humans and on the environment. Plant diseases is a new topic. Today was mentioned we should also look at livestock. It's true, but if you look at livestock disease management, there's a history of 100 years of how animal diseases are treated, eradicated in Europe. The system for plant health is not that well developed. We learned this lecture also now. If you look to southern Italy, to Puglia and Xylella fastidiosa and olive tree disease, which in a way caught us on the wrong leg, I think. Also research-wise, Europe has done not a lot in researching that, different to the United States, so we have to do a lot of things now. And the last example, how to use epidemiological monitoring in risk assessment. To give you one example, there is indication that the use of pesticides could have an effect on degenerative diseases like morbus Parkinson. And we are trying to find out how we could better use epidemiological monitoring in the risk assessment of chemicals. Now, for us, in EFSA, when you look at risk assessment, we basically use three ingredients. And I think we can use the term ingredients if we talk about food. It's methodologies, data, and expertise. How we try to approach these challenges with regards to data is to follow the Open Data Initiative of the European Union, which is easily said, but not that easily done, because most of the data we don't own in EFSA, and if we don't own the data, we cannot publish it, because data is owned by the member states, for example, or it can be owned by applicants that apply for an authorization. And we learn now also with the discussion on glyphosate that the publication of raw data is not a straight way forward. So the open data movement is something we want to exploit, but also new ideas like crowdsourcing to go further out and not just rely on the scientists that work with us, but to go to a greater academic community that could help us with their knowledge in front-running fields of risk assessment. With regards to methodology, I mentioned a few challenges we have, but one rather simple example is the survival of beehives or the bee colony diseases, where we have multiple stressors, biological stressors, chemical stressors, parasites, viruses that affect beehives, and actually we don't have a ready methodology to predict the survival of a beehive because of these multiple stressors, something EFSA is working on. Or just to mention in methodology, the role of epigenetic changes, how epigenetic changes influence the behavior of an organism when it is exposed to chemicals or other stresses. What we try to do internally is, I call it the magic triangle of EFSA, but it's not only true for EFSA, is we try to combine openness, which means engagement with the civil society, with innovation, and collaboration. And the one supports the other, and this could give rise to a virtuous circle, where innovation supports openness, openness supports collaboration, and collaboration, again, innovation. And with innovation, we face a kind of a paradoxon, I would say. Industry is driving innovation in a relentless pace because of competition. But the further industry goes with innovation and not supplying enough data for risk assessment, the bigger becomes the gap between their innovation and our ability to do a proper assessment. Because what you do in risk assessment, when you miss data, you have to insert uncertainty factors. The only way you can handle data gaps is uncertainty factors. So the further industry runs forward with innovation, and us not having the right data and methodology, the more conservative risk assessment has to become. So what we need is a co-evolution between the innovation of industry and the innovation in risk assessment. And you could say one example is engineered nanomaterials, which are on the market, they are used, but the European Parliament is still discussing the definition of nanomaterials. So you could say something is not in line, at least time-wise, between the reality and the political process. So what we want to do, coming back to the first picture, is kind of stitching together actors that are already acting on the market of research, which means services and money that the Commission and the Member States put into research has to be, in a way, aligned with the needs of the safety assessment of EFSA and of other parts, and this has to be aligned again with the needs of the risk managers, which doesn't sound like rocket science, but it's something that has to be done. There needs to be a political will also to do that. What I want to show here, and it's again, I would say, a no-brainer, global trade needs global risk assessment. Which you would say, of course, why not? There's no other way, but we are far away from that, as you know. We still do regional risk assessments, but we need a global approach to risk assessment, which does not mean that we have to have global protection goals. There can be different protection goals in different parts of the world, and this is heavily discussed now under the TTIP negotiations, whether the protection goals of the United States and Europe are the same. But that's a political question of the risk managers. What we need is at least a scientific unified approach to risk assessment. Still a long way to go. And last but not least, I would like to say, from my point of view, enough money is there, basically. Enough brains are there in Europe and outside Europe. What we need is to get connected, and this is why we choose this synapsis, this neuron, as a symbol, to get connected also across the different scientific domains. I think where science is good in is to dig deeper, deeper, and deeper. Where we are not that good in is to connect different scientific domains into something that can be implemented. So I think what is needed is to set priorities on a political level, which needs leadership in Europe, to collaborate across the different scientific disciplines, and then to execute this into something that, at the end, adds value to the society. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bernhard. Now we move to the last talk. Patrizio, Professor Bianchi, is going to talk to you about risk and opportunities for the agri-food, European agri-food, in the frame of the global international markets. Thank you, Patrizio.
No.
Yes.
No, mi hanno montato su una cosa sbagliata. Sorry, we have just a small problem. We are so busy to run from an event to the other, probably they make a mistake in the... Abbiamo un piccolo problema, non mi gira. Vediamo se è quello giusto. No, non è quello giusto.
Ce l'hai qui.
Ok, we can do without slides. Ok, so let me thank you, all of you, for this very kind invitation. When we started to discuss with Fabio about the possibility to have this speech, we say that at the end of this session, we have to explain better why this issue is so relevant for Europe. I don't say for the people working in agribusiness, all the people working in research, but why it's so relevant for Europe as a whole. And this is the sense. When we started, we worked on the basic word of this session. It was Europe, food research, strategy, strategic view, and on the other side, this idea of global dimension. Going through this idea of global dimension, we cannot forget that we are inside a very deep, too long and too slow, said IMF, economic crisis. After the beginning of new century, everybody was expecting a long period of development. On the other side, after 2007, we had a deep crisis. Deep crisis that we can face assuming that the emerging countries can be the real drive of development. In the last few years, also the emerging countries are facing problems. You know the problem of Brazil, you know the problem of Russia, and also China, after reduced of the 50% its own is arrived, huh? Look at what a beautiful technology. Okay, let me run. Europe, thank you so much. Food research, strategy, and global dimension. And we here. Look, what happened? Happened that at the very beginning, we thought that the new century was based on this idea of a very long development. On the other side, after 2007, we had the first crisis, but as you can see, in more recent time, a second collapse. What happened in this situation that the last IMF report last month said 3.2% at global level? Which is the real drive of development at global level? Is still the Asia and China. The major contribution, as you can see, is given by China. Japan more or less disappeared, rest of Asia, United States, and the others. Wow, who are the others? Are we the others? Is Europe the others? Are we in the residual? The other question that is relevant for us is if China is changing game. Changing game means to have a more global dimension. And the answer is yes. Because we know that China now is looking to have global investment in basic infrastructure, like the red one, that is what we can call the new Silk Road, the huge railways from the central China to Europe, or also the sea Silk Road. Let me say something about this huge investment, this huge infrastructure has been done with the Chinese technology. China is very different than the China of 10 years ago. Now China is a technological power. And it was financed by an international fund where Europe has totally more than the 20%. But each European country intervene alone, one by one, so that also the stronger European is marginal. Think about that. Think about that. Not only the new Silk Road, but also the other, the new Trans-Siberian, the new line through all the Central Asia railroads. Big investment, and is reasonable also to ask if the next one is the future map of Europe, where we have also a deep impact for the political position of Europe and for the future of Europe. Is this one the new map of the world? Well, what is it, Europe? It's some place at the margin. So, what we can do? What we can do to avoid the irrelevance of Europe? What strategy for Europe? And now I'm coming back to the issue of today. We have to invest in those areas where we can have a world leadership. For this reason, the discussion of today is so relevant for everybody. We are not speaking simply of an important sector. We are not speaking simply about a relevant business, but we are speaking about one of the major opportunities for Europe to become central in the global dimension. And it's clear that food and research innovation is relevant for the quality of life of most of the people that mentioned before, the impressive figure that we see before, when only a small part of the globe is real fertile, only 13 to 18%. That means that we have to increase the productivity of the land, but also innovate deeply our style of life. But it's also a matter of equity and equality. This right to food as one of the basic rights to live together in this world. You are right, this is crucial. Equity and equality. And on the other side, the quality of life of the people all together are defining the real target, that is a sustainability that is not only environmental, but also social. And so that which are plus and minus of this strategy. Okay, is a clear vision. We have a clear vision. Safety, security, sustainability. Fabio explained beautifully before, at the beginning of this session, that we have a dimension. We have a relevant investment in research and innovation in this field. And in the last speech, we have the idea that this research is able to be transformed in productive capacity, in competencies. We have strong competencies to be leader worldwide. But don't forget it, the real problem of Europe, that is fragmentation of perspectives and dispersion of forces and short-termism. This idea that we have to do everything now, immediately and alone. What we can do finally? Reestablish a long-term perspective for an active role of Europe in the definition and implementation of a global strategy focused on development, welfare, equality, and so peace. In other words, to come back to be Europe.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much also for this last contribution, quite effective. It's the time to move to the next session, and so I apologize, but we cannot go through the discussion that we expected to have. And the last talk also prepared the scene for the next session, which is dealing with the food sustainability, but in particular safety and security at the global level. So I wish to thank the five speakers for their excellent contribution. All the delegates here who were with it, who participated in the session. And now I leave the floor to my colleague, Professor Samuel Goffray, from the University of Laval, Quebec, but also from the Global Institute of Food Security, Queen's University of Belfast in the UK, who will chair the coming session. Then I will return to you later at the end of the second session for a short final conclusion remarks of what has been discussed here. So thank you very much. Thank you very much. We leave. So please, Sam, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Professor Fava. Good afternoon to you all, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be with you this afternoon and to help moderate this second part of our session, our afternoon session. Again, as a continuation to what was discussed earlier, we're going to be taking the discussion beyond the European level and we'll be dealing with the global innovation agenda. As you know, the World Food Forum, being a legacy of Expo 2015, Feeding the Planet, Energy for Life, aims to be, amongst other things, a major catalyst to a food research and innovation agenda globally. And again, this initiative can be, in fact, the platform that mobilizes knowledge exchange, strategy development, commitment, and hopefully even investment in the area of food and in the area of food innovation in particular. So again, if food safety, food security, and sustainability represent challenges, research and innovation can be the opportunity to address these challenges. And to help us discuss this theme and potentially shape the agenda of what this forum could do to contribute to food innovation and research globally, we have a panel of experts and eminent speakers who have kindly agreed to be with us this afternoon. And we will follow a similar form for our discussion. We will start with opening remarks and introductions from Her Excellency the Minister Palma Costi, who is the Minister for Productive Activities, Energy Plan, Green Economy for the region of Emilia-Romagna, and we welcome Minister Costi with us. And then we will continue with a number of experts who will provide us with some insights on innovation and food in the broadest sense possible, covering hopefully trends, needs, and challenges globally. I'm going to invite our speakers to join the panel, and I'm going to introduce them very briefly. You have their biographies and extensive description of expertise in your documents. We have the pleasure of welcoming Dr. Mei Zhurong, who is the Director General of the Department of Research Management at the Chinese Academy of Agriculture Science. Welcome. We have the privilege also to have with us Professor Riccardo Valentini, who is the Strategic Director for the European Mediterranean Center for Climate Change and also member of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and Barilla Center for Food and Nutrition Foundation. We have the opportunity of having with us one of Europe's best and finest food experts and food safety experts, one of the most cited academics, Professor Rudy Kruszka, the head of the Center for Analytical Chemistry at the University of Natural Resources and Life Sciences, BOKU, in Austria. We have also Dr. Vittorio Zambrini, representing the industry sector, who is the Director of Quality, Innovation, Security and Environment at Granarolo, here from Italy. And we also have the privilege of having with us Michael Backer, the Director of Global Food Services from Google. Do we have Michael with us, or? Yes, I know that his presentation arrived, but nonetheless, we'll see if he can join us later on. I didn't have any news as to potential issues with participation from Mr. Backer. Without further ado, I would like to invite Assessore Palma Costi to give her introductory remarks and to kick off this discussion. Assessore, please.
Grazie. Io volevo fare alcune riflessioni anche su questa iniziativa che stiamo facendo come Regione Emilia-Romagna, su questa piattaforma che abbiamo lanciato. Noi siamo una regione che ha una responsabilità, crediamo, molto grande rispetto a queste tematiche, perché siamo una regione che ha raggiunto un livello di benessere molto importante, di benessere dei cittadini, in larga parte ha risolto anche alcuni dei temi che vengono affrontati oggi, e quindi è una regione che ha il dovere di proporsi sul piano globale per affrontare in modo più innovativo possibile il tema di come si può avere del cibo sano, nutriente, e anche come si può avere appunto del cibo per tutti. Noi abbiamo accettato questa sfida, che è una sfida globale, cercando però di lavorare con delle azioni concrete. Questo credo che sia uno degli approcci che occorre assolutamente avere, diciamo, da parte di tutti i soggetti che fanno parte di questa grande mobilitazione mondiale contro i cambiamenti climatici, contro, diciamo, la fame, e quindi per questo diritto. Noi crediamo molto nell'azione locale, e noi come governo regionale, forti di un sistema agroalimentare che in Emilia-Romagna ha più di 30.000 imprese, più di 180.000 addetti, come diceva il Presidente questa mattina, abbiamo più di 5 miliardi di export, 43 prodotti DOP e IGP, quindi prodotti di alta qualità. Abbiamo più di 5.000 operatori che operano nel biologico, e lascerò poi ad una parte delle imprese che sono qui presente questo sviluppo. Abbiamo però davvero il dovere di lavorare soprattutto su quella parte che è la parte fondamentale di questa nostra piattaforma, è il tema della ricerca e quindi dell'innovazione. Ecco, su questo noi abbiamo lavorato tantissimo come regione negli anni trascorsi, e oggi possiamo davvero contare in questa regione di un sistema di ricerca pubblico e anche in collaborazione col privato, fatto per quanto riguarda tutta la parte dell'agroalimentare, di 180 gruppi di ricerca che possono affiancare le nostre imprese, che possono affiancare, diciamo, tutti gli operatori, e che possono davvero supportare il percorso del cibo dalla terra alla tavola. perché abbiamo un sistema organizzato anche sulla base appunto di questi nostro, di questa nostra piattaforma dell'agroalimentare, che affronta alcuni temi sui quali si sta lavorando con azioni molto molto concrete e anche con risultati. Il tema della qualità delle materie prime, questo è un tema fondamentale, nuovi metodi per la sicurezza degli alimenti, alimenti che siano nutrienti e quindi che siano sani, quindi la qualità e la tipicità dei nostri alimenti. Affrontiamo il tema delle microorganismi di interesse agroalimentare per il tema anche della conservazione, tutto il tema della tracciabilità, quindi anche questo è un altro elemento importante. Stiamo lavorando sul tema delle macchine e degli impianti per tutta la parte che riguarda chiaramente sempre la lavorazione, voglio dire sia dalla terra ma fino ad arrivare anche al prodotto finito, la valorizzazione anche dei sottoprodotti dell'industria agroalimentare, che è uno degli altri grandi elementi, perché non c'è solo lo spreco dal punto di vista dei prodotti finiti, ma c'è anche un tema del recupero di tutti i prodotti e il tema del packaging. Per cui concretamente in questa regione si sta lavorando su progetti tipo come allungare la vita dei prodotti sugli scaffali e renderli più sicuri con sistemi chiaramente sicurissimi, come appunto conservare gli alimenti. Stiamo lavorando moltissimo su tutto il tema degli strumenti di precisione, perché anche qui è un altro elemento fondamentale, quindi strumenti di precisione che riguardano tutto quanto. Uno degli ultimi progetti su cui si sta lavorando è per esempio sul grado di maturazione della frutta, cioè quindi sistemi che sono in grado di comprendere e capire quando la frutta è raccoglibile. Si sta lavorando per esempio su un settore che è quello della macellazione per il riutilizzo degli scarti. Questo lo stiamo facendo concretamente con il nostro sistema di ricerca pubblica che sosteniamo e che finanziamo come regione. L'altro elemento importante sul quale stiamo lavorando in questa regione, che credo che sia una delle altre grandi opportunità, prima ha parlato il mio collega Patrizio Bianchi, che si occupa della formazione, quindi della costruzione anche di una cultura e di una mentalità, soprattutto nei giovani, e proprio perché stiamo investendo moltissimo sulla scuola e sull'università, noi oggi siamo una regione che sta sfornando moltissimi giovani che si dedicano a fare impresa. Abbiamo start-up innovative davvero importanti anche su questo, su questo settore, e anche qui abbiamo delle risposte molto molto importanti, risposte che vanno nuovamente da quale può essere il cibo del futuro, tutto il tema dell'allevamento degli insetti, non solo ad uso esclusivamente alimentare per mangimi, ma anche per esempio per estrarre le proteine da riutilizzare con altre modalità, al tema dell'agricoltura di precisione, come vi dicevo prima, quindi con sistemi molto sofisticati in grado di elaborare sia la gestione, per esempio, del settore dell'ortofrutticoltura che la logistica, modelli di simulazione. Queste sono start-up che oggi stanno operando in questa regione, che sono in grado di supportare, per esempio, le imprese dalla semina al raccolto, con l'attenzione anche a come evitare per esempio lo sviluppo di malattie. Quindi per cui stiamo davvero, questa sfida, che è una sfida voglio dire a livello globale, stiamo cercando di sostenerla e di implementarla con delle azioni concrete a livello locale, che per noi però non possono rimanere a livello locale, sono importanti, ma proprio per questo noi stiamo cercando di essere all'interno della rete di progettazione europea. Noi siamo una di quelli che ha partecipato e ha, come si dice, ottenuto anche parecchi finanziamenti per quanto riguarda proprio la progettazione per la bioeconomia, e siamo impegnati con queste nostre esperienze, quindi fatto di un sistema pubblico molto forte sulla formazione, molto forte sulla ricerca e sull'innovazione, forte anche sul sistema di creare imprese in questo settore, e siamo impegnati anche in campi importanti come quelli della ricerca, per esempio impegnata nella cooperazione internazionale, anche qui con operazioni molto molto concrete. Stiamo sostenendo progetti molto importanti, oltretutto credo progetti anche molto molto sostenibili, perché portiamo nella cooperazione internazionale un diciamo modello di sviluppo che è fatto di tanti soggetti, soprattutto anche piccoli soggetti, quindi anche piccole imprese, piccole attività, oltre ad, come si dice, affrontare il tema della cooperazione sempre con tutta la filiera, quindi non semplicemente il fare impresa, ma anche tutto il tema della formazione, il supporto, come si dice, anche all'innovazione e alla ricerca. Questo è il motivo per cui come regione, lo dicevano prima nella sessione precedente, abbiamo sostenuto e stiamo sostenendo così fortemente questa piattaforma, perché noi crediamo che oggi, a fronte di queste sfide che sono state accettate dai governi, sono state accettate, voglio dire, dalle organizzazioni, sono state accettate anche da tutto il sistema delle imprese, quello che oggi davvero c'è bisogno è quello di avere anche molta concretezza, quindi essere molto operativi, perché il tempo non è tanto, il tempo è poco rispetto alle sfide che noi abbiamo, ed essere soprattutto in grado di avere un sistema che sia in grado di mettere in condizione di dialogare, colloquiare tutti i soggetti in modo indipendente, anche in modo, voglio dire, scientificamente alto, proprio per contribuire a livello locale a iniziare a dare delle risposte concrete e chiaramente riuscire poi a tradurre anche in azioni a livello globale per permettere una transizione molto più veloce di quella che sarebbe diciamo successo, di quella che potrebbe succedere nel momento in cui non ci sono anche delle azioni condivise a livello globale. Per cui noi non solo crediamo in questa, diciamo, in questa grande, come si dice, in questa grande sfida, ma vogliamo essere proprio protagonisti anche con esempi concreti, anche con modalità, anche di governo, perché anche questa è un'operazione, quella che stiamo conducendo, è un'operazione chiaramente di governo fatta non solo dalla regione, ma da tante istituzioni che in questa nostra regione ci supportano. Grazie.
Thank you, Minister. And thank you also for expressing yourself so clearly, such that I felt that my Italian has improved exponentially. We're going to start with our experts, and I guess actually I omitted to mention, last but not least, another contributor to our panel, who is going to be our second speaker. And I would like to introduce Dr. Filippo Bassi, who leads the International Center for Agricultural Research in the Dry Areas and leads, in fact, a breeding program in wheat, and is going to be essentially sharing his experience with us. Thank you for contributing to our panel, and welcome.
It is indeed my absolute pleasure. Thank you very much to the organizer for inviting me. Most people might not know I was born no more than 30 kilometers away from here. And we have one thing, people from this region, when the region calls, we come. I was in a mission in Lebanon, and so I very quickly drop everything, jump on a flight 5 a.m., and here I am. So I work at ICARDA together with CIMID, which is where Dr. Ajaram did most of his work, our international center, and together they create what is known as the Global Program in Wheat, CRP Wheat. And we are under the umbrella of CGIAR, which is this FAO-created group, to actually do wheat research in the developing world, emerging country, I guess is the correct term today. I'd like to start my presentation with this picture of a child in Syria. This was way, way before anything bad happened in Syria. That's when ICARDA was still based there. What the child is doing is burning green spikes of durum wheat to make one of the most nutritious products of durum wheat, which is not pasta. It's called frike, very typical of our thing. And I think it gives you a very good idea of how complex is the region where I work and how many products we are really thinking about. This is actually their region. We call it Siwana. I think we are the only one doing that. Central, West Asia, and North Africa. And I think I really like this picture here because it shows very clearly what was presented just before. I apologize, omitted the name, about one quarter of land, one quarter of hectare per person. All the area that in red here shows places in this region where people cannot have enough agriculture resources to actually survive. Unfortunately, our region has a lot of red. And just a comment to gain a cookie point from our chairman and other people in the area. This whole area, the Mediterranean, actually is a major pasta economy market, and it's worth about $15 billion per year. But what we have to do is to thank Canada, which is the country that is providing one quarter of the grain that is used to making pasta today. So when tonight or tomorrow you eat pasta, if you have a Canadian next to you, thank him, and also thank our industry that is using to make this pasta. So we heard this in many different ways. I want to say this in the breeder way, my way. We don't produce enough. And we will certainly not produce enough for the future unless we do change something. The way breeders measure this is through this formula, which is called genetic gain. It's a component of the intensity, how big is my breeding program, accuracy, how good is my eye and my data to pick something better than the one they had before, and heritability, how good I am in bringing something that was in my parents to my sons and daughters. And so currently in the world, in terms of breeding, developing countries are somewhere around 0.5% per year of genetic gain. In developed countries, we have managed some people somewhere to invest a little bit in one of these three places. Rather, they improve their field stations. Rather, they invest in making bigger breeding, or they manage to get more marker and genomes. So we are somewhere around 1%. And where we need to be in order to meet the global demand is 2%. And we don't have to do 2% only in the developed world, but we have to be 2% everywhere in the world. That will mean that that one quarter of an hectare will be enough to sustain 10 billion people. Okay? So it's a little challenge right there, but we have the formula, we know how to deal with this. And that's what my presentation will focus on. If I can move forward. There it is. So this is one of the most beautiful fields in the world when it comes to wheat. It's the field where Dr. Rajaram worked for many, many, many years of his excellent career. This is Mexico, this is CIMIT. And each one of those little squares you see is one potential new variety. The more of this I plant is like the casino. The more you bet, the more you lose, but also the more chance you have to win. This is exactly what we need to have. We need to have enough money to bet a lot. The more we bet, the more chance we have to find a new variety. This is another example. Instead of improving accuracy, this is roots. They are very, very important for a plant. This is a genetic diversity. So imagine to take now all those plots that I show, and for each one of them, look at their roots. Some of them are more narrow in terms of angle, so they tend to go deeper. Other more superficial, so they tend to be more on the surface. Now, in terms of innovation, if I can look for this everywhere, I can find those plants that in the Mediterranean region, where drought normally occurs toward the end of spring, the moisture of the soil disappears, goes down to the bottom, deeper roots are like a big straw. I can keep drinking and produce more. Another example, this picture down here is something you would see this year in Morocco, but this picture was taken several years back. You have on the left-hand side a variety of wheat that is resistant to that, I don't know if you can see it, very nasty pest. It's called Asian fly, Meiovera destructora, and you see it's like kind of like a blade in the back. It's a very nasty guy. Imagine as a very weaponized mosquito that only attacks wheat. And you see on the right-hand side, that farmer will harvest nothing. So on one side, we have the ability of producing a resistant variety. On the other side, farmers are still growing one that are not resistant. By the way, this insect, as you can see, has wings and is in Morocco. How far is that from Europe? So it's very also hard to work on this in terms of breeding. The ability to actually select for this is not easy. You need to have specific fields and specific conditions. So we start developing what are called molecular tools, and this one is called QTL analysis, or marker work. Some of you might be familiar with it. Some of them might be curious to find more about it. And basically what it does allows us to select for this gene with some degree of accuracy, so that the picture down the bottom will not happen again. However, we are still a few steps far away from being completely sure about this. And to be completely sure, we need to do what is known as cloning, really landing on the one gene that we care about. And to do cloning, we need to do another difficult thing, which is called sequencing. So these are big words. But there's an initiative from Italy that is really pushing forward this in terms of durum wheat. And when that happens, we'll make sure that this picture will be a story of the past. Until then, we wait and hope that they manage to find the funds they need to do this. Just to have an idea, you know, when you think about research, lots of people think about like an investment that will disappear. So Simit and Icarda went through a very thorough review of the last 10 years of our work. And what it turned out to be that every second variety that is grown today by farmers actually is derived from the work of people like Rajaram, and hopefully in the future the work that I'm doing. And that is worth about $3 billion per year. Using our material gives about $3 billion return. And knowing our budget is around $30 million per year to do this whole work in the developing world, this is what finance people would call a return on investment, or ROI, of 100 times. And as far as I understood this, that means it's a startup that is worth funding 100 times. So we've been doing this for now 60 years, 50 years. We're still a startup worth funding every year. So that's not bad. A more practical and personal, if I might, example was last October in Ethiopia. This is a farmer there. That I visit was definitely my best day last year of 2015. What this farmer is showing me is that in his left hand, the seed he has in the left hand, are the seed that the old variety that he had, Ude, would provide him. The two hands together are the seeds that a new variety developed by Icarda, by my program, is giving him, about double the amount. After a long conversation and quite a bit of help in translation, turns out to be he's now making about $1,000 more per year, per hectare. That's enough money to send the kids to school. That's a big, practical, down-to-earth impact. And one last example that I want to give, maybe, yes, is the work we do along the Senegal River. This is Mauritania, Senegal, and Mali, sub-Saharan Africa. We have developed what we call heat-tolerant and super-early varieties. What they did, they went into Mali, and there was a window of about 3 months where rice cultivation was not possible. And those 3 months, they couldn't cultivate anything. Now with this variety, they can cultivate them in that window. And the great thing, that these produce up to 4 tons per hectare. That's more than we need. That's a lot of new food that we're creating down there. All we need now is to connect this to proper market that can purchase at a good international price, give back the seeds that our industry needs, and we have created a new economical market of up to $450 million per year in sub-Saharan Africa. Everybody happy, everybody wins. In conclusion, I think if you don't know the challenges yet, it means we are really looking for something quite unexpected, but I think every one of us has a quite clear picture of what are the challenges. The funny thing that for once, we have the solutions. It's very clear. We need to produce more per unit of land, and we need to do it in a more sustainable way. So all we really need to do, we need to fund research, breeding, and agronomy. On top of that, we even know that that gives you back money. Our return on investment is 100 times. It's very, very high. So how can we possibly fail? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this insightful presentation, and I guess actually it's very hopeful, so we'll see how this initiative could potentially help. We're going to move to, again, continuing our global view and move to a presentation from Dr. Mei Zhurong from the Chinese Academy of Agricultural Sciences.
Thank you, Chair. It's my pleasure to be here to introduce some research and innovation in Chinese agriculture. China Chinese agriculture has a very scarcity of land and water, but it has relatively high productivity if you look at in the picture. But last year, the gross grain productions that already reached to 621 million tons. But if you look at in the food input out of China, the number is over 100 million tons also. So it's a high productivity, but also high input. And how China can use such scarce land and water to produce more food? One reason is we invest a lot of chemical fertilizers that is amount of one-third of the world chemical fertilizer that was used in Chinese agriculture. The second, if you look at the land explore intensity, in view of the productivity per unit land, the Chinese land now is almost 3 times more than the world average. It's over exploitation. The third, we look at in irrigation. So 6% of the renewable fresh water that we developed, more than half of the cultivated land was irrigated. So this is all the pictures that why Chinese agriculture is a high productivity, but it's based on the very scarce land and the water resources. In the past 30 years, if you look at the picture on the left, we saw that the yield improvement is the major driver that to put forward in the gross grain production increment. And also, in the table that you look at it in the land was a shift to the industry and urbanization, and also the irrigation water also, the amount of irrigation water was also reduced. But we gain a high productivity, productions is mainly due to the investment of science and technology. Currently, science and technology is the first power that to put forward the Chinese agricultural growth. But in the past 30 years, a series of new varieties was released, and even new livestock breeders, healthy farming, and the disease control for livestock, poultry, and even agriculture. And techniques that are released control fertilizer, biopesticides, was the harvesting and the conservation technology, even circular agriculture technologies is popularized in agriculture productions. Even advanced equipment of farming machineries and plant factory, and we use a lot of solar greenhouse to produce vegetables, and biogas and the food processing technologies are already used widely in agriculture. But challenges are still rigorous. So we name the challenge as currently is REMAP. As it means that we help to rebuild consumer confidence that for the domestic food. I think European people, they have a feeling that the Chinese people like to buy everything from abroad, including some dairy productions. So we have high productions, but the local consumer sometimes will select some food that exports from foreign countries. We need to improve competitive abilities, as you, if you, remind me first the pictures, first the slides, that high invest of fertilizer, even pesticides, irrigation, is however to increase the cost of food productions. So it's consequently reducing the competitive abilities. And also we need maximizing the potential productivity for less resources for more food, and also enhance the agriculture multifunctions to develop some agriculture biodiversities and ecological service. Even we need to develop some metro agriculture, house and garden, agriculture heritage, and promote ecological civilizations as pollution control from agriculture sectors, and accelerating modernization transition. So this is the major challenge currently in Chinese agriculture. How the food production in the age of a transition in China? Now, we mean the transition, it means the Chinese agriculture now is just the move from a traditional agriculture to the modern agriculture. In this kind of transition, we adopted the new concepts on innovation, coordination, a green growth, opening up, and the sharing, develop the concepts. And we helped to do some supply side reform that for this transition and upgrading. Following 5 to 10 years, Chinese agriculture have to maintain a certain amount of major food productivity, something like cereal productions, rice, and wheat. And also need to provide a safer and a nutritional food for the consumers. And also reduce consumption of land and water and the chemicals, and also reduce pollution for sustainability. And we need also reduce production costs for market competitive, improve resiliences and the risk control for climate change, adaptation, and the greenhouse gas emission control. Also, we need to enhance emerging industry and the new agribusiness. Now, finally, we need to deepen land tenure reform and build new agro corporations. As people know that in China, a smaller scale farmer is the major patents for corporations. And new agro corporations means the union or community of the small farmer. And something like that is developing rapidly in currently in China. But what's the needs of science and technology innovation for transitional driven in China? We look at globally and domestically, and we list here for breedings, for digital and intelligent machineries, and the green inputs like smart fertilizers, and rapid precise diagnosis technologies, and also technologies integrations for regional sustainable development of efficient use of natural resources, and also in major industry technology and the new agribusiness model innovations. We have many, but it is more priorities. The four innovation clusters we listed here, and for biomics, synthetics, genome editorial technologies for new, precise, and targeted animal and plant breedings. and the stem cell and the cell engineering technologies for pharmaceutical molecular design, and also intelligent equipment, big data, internet of the intelligent for smart agriculture. Green import, even nano pesticides and the fertilizers was developed by now, and also we need to some integration solutions for regional agricultural development. So under this background, what's the research and the innovation governance for transitional agriculture from a central government to the local government? Now in China, there is some arrangement of research and the innovation in China. One is about agriculture science and technology innovation program. And this program was pioneered by Chinese Academy of Agricultural Sciences and invented by research and innovation, as well as capacity building, and powered by the mechanism of recreation. That means a team-based research mechanism was adopted for this innovation program. The second is a national alliance for agriculture, science, and technology innovation. This alliance was established by the end of 2014. So this alliance that was consolidated, financed by central government and the provincial government for not competitive, for sustainable support for the collaborative research all over China. And also we target four clusters of the science and technology innovation contents. The third, that we build up a national transfer and a service center for agriculture and science and technology achievements. This was set up last year and only used for introduce the latest research findings that to the potential users, even the farmer, the agriculture corporations, and tasks was already undertaken to improve research funding and consolidated the technical integration and the transfer, and also scale up and strengthen industries of science and technologies. So the last is the central government has a plan to expand international cooperation in agriculture and the food productions. And the one aspect is accelerates the global layout. That means that China, the joint lab is the major patterns that to enhance the cooperation between the Chinese institutions and the abroad institutions. Central government hope that it can launch an international mega program for science and technology innovation. Some initiative was listed here, like GMAPS, epidemic fibers, climate smart crop livestock system. Now was initiative that hope that can strengthen the cooperation with the country surrounding China. Also, with alliance with the International Science and Technology Program, we think that Chinese Academy of Agricultural Sciences are much more involved in the CGIAR program, the Horizon 2020 Bill Gates Foundations. So already is a global player also. The last is we adopt the program, a high-level talent exchange program. The young Chinese was sent abroad, and also some international talent was introduced that to work with us for international corporations. Thank you, and hope our experience can build a synergy for the common challenge. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing with us China's experience in addressing the challenge, essentially, of enhancing the production and also your research and innovation agenda. We're going to shift gears now to another topic that has an influence, certainly, on food production, and also that is influenced as well by it, and this is climate change, and we're going to start with an introduction from Professor Valentini from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. Please.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Okay, I'm trying to spend just a few minutes in giving you some messages on what has been also referred before by Mr. Xuron as a big transformation of agriculture to cope with many critical issues. Okay, the first one I think that I want to put to your attention is the great acceleration that we are facing today. So we are not in a position today to think of a transitional society, slow adaptation, or things like that. We have very, very fast transformations. You see here indicators from socioeconomics or earth systems, processes. All of them are exponential. All of them are growing very fast. Everything is happening in the last 50 years, much more than in any century in the past. So we are in a situation where the conventional thinking is not anymore helpful for us. We have to look to real change in our mentality, in our way to think, particularly to the agri-food sector. And one of these big changes, of course, is population. Everybody knows this graph. And you can see, for example, that since 1960, we have increased by 4 billion of people in only 50 years. But the problem is that not only the 9 billion people that we have in 2050 as, of course, a big challenge for food systems, but also the quality of population. In 2010, we reached the parity between rural and urban people. And from 2010, we are growing and heading to 2050, where we have eight people over 10 in 2050 will live in big cities. Only two people will live in the countryside, in rural places. So who's going to produce food in 2050? It's a big question. This is why we need maybe new way, new things to put in place for responding to this new urban challenge. And of course, we have also trying to catch up the need of food using more land, using as much as possible land. And we are currently deforesting tropical forests at a rate of about 13 million of hectares per year. Just to give an idea, Italian forest area is about 10 million of hectares. So we destroy every year more than Italian forests globally to create more space for food production. So we're trying to catch up the increase of population. But at the same time, this catching up is not effective because in the 60s, we had about 1.6 hectares of land per capita. Today, we are about 0.7. So even if we deforest the tropical forests, we don't have enough land to meet our demands. This is why things are so critical and so fast. And why? Because it's not only food demand in terms of direct food production. It's also animal feed. We have seen also before in our Mr. Sukron presentation, but also biofuel demands that is also growing in the future. That's a a big challenge. So we have to decide at some point whether we want to feed ourselves all cars. And agriculture is in the middle of this big change. One, because it's partly responsible for climate change as producing greenhouse gases, at the same time receiving the effects of climate change, to be impacted by changes in climate. Agriculture is the only sector that depends directly to climate. So other sectors of industry, economy, some way they can cope, but agriculture is directly impacted by climate change. And of course, agriculture has been relevant in the last, 50 years in increasing greenhouse gas emissions and producing global warming. 2.7 billion tons of CO2 equivalent were emitted in 1961, and today almost we are 5.4. We doubled agricultural emissions in the last 50 years. And of course, climate change will have an important effect on sustainability of food production. This is a recent paper showing the current capacity of the food system in response to climate change. And the first panel you see here is the situation where basically we use the same diet as today. And the blue, more or less, scenarios are the population growth at the end of the century. And the yellow envelope is the amount, how much people we can feed under that climate change. You see there is a gap. There's about between 2 and 5 billion people will not have enough food at the end of the century under the current diet. But if the diet, for example, is moving to more meat consumption, that is, unfortunately, there is a close correlation between per capita income and meat consumption, and it's almost proportional. So you are more rich, you eat more meat. And again, you see even the situation becomes more worse. The gap is between 4 or 7 billion people without food at the end of the century. So there is a real importance on what we really eat. I mean, 20 years ago, nobody of us were thinking that what we eat has an impact on global problems or climate change. Today, we have this real recognition that what we eat makes a difference. Our lifestyles makes a difference. Our diets makes differences. Of course, climate change is under high relevance in the media. Everybody's speaking of climate change. It's true. It's a scientific problem indeed. And the IPCC report has shown and confirmed clearly. And we have global warming and extreme events predicted in the future that can affect our food system as well, our water resources and natural systems. You can see from this picture, just as one of the global pictures, where there are different places in the world with different degree of warming. It's not that all the globe will be equivalent. And this is an interesting question for food systems, particularly looking at the border regions where you have more warming, and also compare with tropical or temperate regions. And indeed, what happens, and this is the result of the IPCC work of the last report, is that we have a clear differentiation of climate impacts on two regions. One is the temperate regions where, for example, there will be some kind of a reduction of yield through by climate effect, but adaptation, so the way in which we use technology and we respond with agronomic practices or genetics and so on, is able to really equilibrate or to respond to climate effects. So basically, we can respond to climate with adaptation. The other places, like tropical regions, where climate effects will be more severe and even adaptation will not be effective. So that's something that we have to take in mind, or at least the current adaptation solutions are not working in the current model. So we may look at different solutions in the future. And the impacts of climate change will be not the same across the world. As I said, tropical regions mostly affected, temperate regions to some extent, but you can see also green areas here. So there will be some positive effects of climate, particularly if you look at border regions. Canada, for example, our chairman is probably very happy about that, or Russia. There will be possibly areas where agriculture could expand. I mean, of course, it's potentially, we don't know yet, but there is some signals in this direction. And so we have indeed the global paradoxes also. It's not only climate our problem. There are also problems like, for example, our lifestyles. We have about 800 people that are undernutrition today and 1.5 billion of people that are overweight, as well as, again, we have food that is produced. This is the land occupied by food production, and again, we have quite a lot of land that is dedicated to fodder for animals or for biofuels. And of course, we have the I think the most, at least ethical problem is we lost about 1.3 billion of food waste every year, and is something that is not compatible with the big challenges we have in front of us. So I'm concluding, as I said before, we it's very difficult to imagine a slow transitional process for responding to these big challenges. So at least this is my opinion, but I think that with other colleagues, we have been together 2 weeks ago in a BCFN forum, about 20 experts trying to, you know, look at this problem. And finally, I think we need really to go for paradigm shifts, so something that really changed our way to consider the food system. First of all, we have to reconnect agriculture with the food system. This has been said already today, this morning. So we cannot decouple the farmers, the people working in the land producing food, from the food system, from the industry, and from the consumers. So we have to be part, all of us, of big change. So we cannot go in the farm and say you have to reduce greenhouse gas emissions at the same time having consumers that asking for food that is very, very available every season, every time, and so consuming a lot of energy and resources. So it's something that we have to create in a global system altogether. The other point is that we have to include true costs in food. What is the true cost of food? I mean, is equivalency between a food that I grow with you know, sustainable practices that is low environmental pressures and so on, compared with another one that has consumed a lot of resources, water, fertilizer, and so on. I think we should look at that. And the true cost, the externalities, the positive and negative externalities, should be taken into account in the food value. It's something that is challenging. I don't think that it's easy to convince everybody, but we have to make a reflection on that. And the other point is what we can do about the urban areas. That's a really big problem. I mean, 20 million cities, mega cities, are growing everywhere in Africa and South Asia. And the areas around cities are very important for agricultural production. So planning of at least maintaining those areas in close connection with the urban areas is very important, even inside, of course, urban areas, but also mostly thinking to the areas around the towns for agricultural production are so important for the survival of the many, many people that work living in the urban areas. Of course, agriculture is also important. It's not only a problem for climate warming. It can be also a solution. It's been also reminded today, I remember there was somebody referring to carbon sequestration in the soil. Yes, indeed, agriculture can be also reverted to be a solution. We have to work on that, not only considering it as a negative effect. And finally, we need to go for a full transition to the agroecology and circular economy, as has been also mentioned. That's important because we have a lot of waste that is not used, reused, or upcycled in the food supply chain. Okay, so finally, there are possible some solutions that go from a global governance of the food system, the overall food system. We're looking forward to the SDGs implementation, as well as COP21 should include food as one important element of the climate change. Incentives has to be guided in the direction of a change in the paradigm of a sustainable agriculture, the true value of food. Education to the consumers, lifestyles, nutrition is also playing an important role, and also focusing on implementation on solutions that are not only small scale, because there are good examples at small scale, but we need to change and
make in a way that this small scale solution become a coalition of big changes at bigger scale. Otherwise, we don't change the system. Of course, tools important are having data, monitoring, open data, access. The food system is still not transparent. We need more data and open and accessible to everyone. Of course, we need more innovation, smart innovation, automation, particularly if you look at these two guys in the land that all the rest will be in the town. They should work for everybody. They need automation. They need help. They need technology to do their work, but also to respond to climate change, of course. And of course, we need also best practices. And this is why we need a really north-south-south-south cooperation at all level, because the practices, the best practice of change is an important driver for big change. Otherwise, we are not meeting the challenge that we have in front of us. Thank you.
Thank you very much again for highlighting these interdependencies between the food sector and climate change, and also the role that innovation can make in addressing that. We're going to move now to our next expert speaking now to issues related to food safeties and the interdependencies with the innovation, but also some connections to climate change, Professor Kruschka from the University of Natural Resources and Life Sciences in Austria.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen. I know something about food safety and food analysis, but you might be disappointed in me when I tell you that I am not an expert in climate change. Having said that, my university, BOKU, in Vienna, they are very serious about climate change, and that is why we're also among the top 10 green rhetoric universities worldwide. And believe it or not, I have to pay a CO2 compensation fee when traveling actually by plane from Vienna to Bologna, and the situation will be even worse when I will be visiting our chairman in Canada next month. So, equally serious is obviously the issue of climate change, and I would like to address a couple of issues, emerging issues in this in respect to food safety and also technologies, how we can brace ourselves in view of these challenges to come. Well, climate change influencing the food system. So you have heard about a couple of predictions related to climate change. So we are all aware of temperature increase, variation, precipitation, drought, increase of atmospheric CO2. So Professor Valentini has actually quite nicely alluded to all these aspects. And there are a couple of predicted impacts on agriculture, like crop yields have already been alluded to as well. Soil quality actually with nutrients literally being washed out of the soil. Also crop associated biological environment will and can be influenced as, for instance, with different types of microorganisms occurring under different climatic conditions. So that actually potentially makes our food system vulnerable towards a couple of issues in relation to the occurrence of contaminants. I will particularly dwell on natural toxins, so-called biotoxins, but I will also briefly address pesticides in view of an increased prevalence of plant diseases, pests which are predicted. We will be facing an increasing use of pesticides, also trace elements as a result of extreme weather conditions can again be washed out of the soils, and also like PEHs, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, we can face here some secondary emission effects due to elevated temperatures. So these are just some of the issues, and I can basically skip this slide because of Professor Valentino's presentation. Well, you have heard about CO2 increase in the atmosphere on the one hand, temperature increase on the other hand. So this is ideal for promoting photosynthesis. So with that in mind, there is it's not a big surprise that we will be facing increased crop yields in the northern parts, which will unfortunately, I guess, not be making up for the loss of more than 30%. Certainly there's some uncertainty of these predictions in the southern parts. Well, a very important issue related to food safety is the formation of harmful algal blooms. So we will be facing enhanced formation of marine biotoxins. So for instance, paralytic neurotoxins, which accumulate in shellfish and in all sorts of seafood. So we will have to come up in the future with improved monitoring systems to monitor the quality of water, to monitor also these algal blooms, and particularly phycotoxins in the foods, especially seafood. And well, there is a big challenge here because there's a great variety of different compounds, especially congeners, and we have to establish the right analytical methodology for that. Even more important is the occurrence of mycotoxins, which are actually toxic secondary metabolites produced by fungi, especially Aspergillus, the well-known producer of aflatoxins, but in Europe we have a prevalence of so-called fusarium mycotoxin. I give you here some facts. Actually, in 2014, the majority of EU's rapid alert system for food and feed rejections were due to mycotoxin contamination. These actually account also for 5 to 10% of annual crop losses worldwide. And in certain years, actually, we can easily exceed a 1 billion euro loss in Europe alone, with an additional billion in the US. So the prediction in relation to the microorganisms and fungi, also well-known producers of mycotoxins, is that these plant pathogens and pests are moving about a 3 to 5 kilometers velocity per year, kilometers per year, towards the poles, which means that we can expect some aflatoxins, which are usually only known to occur in southern hotter parts of the world, to move towards middle Europe and even northern Europe. And this issue is further exacerbated, for instance, by insects moving also towards the north as the European corn borer, which enable the fungi to grow or to augment much more rapidly and much more efficiently, for instance, on a corn cob, as shown here, ending up again at higher levels of mycotoxins. So is there any evidence for such issues? Well, yes, in 2012, there has been the so-called Serbian maize scandal with a couple of thousand tons of aflatoxin-contaminated maize being imported to Germany. This was actually due to severe drought in 2012, ended up with a ban of milk delivery due to carcinogen scare in Serbia and in Germany as a result of aflatoxin M1. Which could be present as a result of metabolization of aflatoxin in the body of animals. And, well, is now aflatoxin the new toxin to be monitored in Europe? Well, in 2012, there were severe floodings, low temperature, and almost no aflatoxin occurrence. Well, in Europe we have here a strong emphasis on the economical standpoint, and also of agricultural industry is severely affected in some years from mycotoxins. In the developing regions, the fungal toxins are a much greater issue, especially for humans, African children actually suffering from fungal toxins, as recently being reported in the Science magazine. Well, independent whether we are looking into the industrialized world or into developing countries, we have to expect the unexpected. So due to climate change, extreme weather conditions, we are facing sometimes a really unexpected occurrence data in relation to mycotoxins. So that is why, for instance, in our lab, we have developed a multi-analyte method which covers actually a wide range of secondary metabolites being potentially harmful to humans and animals. Well, the story is actually even more complicated. This is obviously not the underground system of London or of Vienna. This is the global map of metabolic pathways. And if we would like to contribute to food safety on the one hand by anticipating some of toxic substances entering our food supply, but also to ensure food security on the other hand, to, for instance, end up, as Professor Bassi said, with some resistant plant crops, we have to understand entire biological systems and pathways as a basis for these systems. So this is just showing you DON, the major mycotoxins we've got in Europe, and we know now, based on such studies, that actually resistant plants are able to couple a sugar molecule to a mycotoxin and thus detoxifying it. And well, now we know that resistant plants are able to do this sort of detoxification, now actually indicated by the upper half of this slide here. We have now a shift towards another mycotoxin, which actually does not enable the plant anymore to perform this sort of detoxification. So we have a very complex system of microorganisms, of pathogens on the one hand, and plants on the other hand, which we will have to consider. And in order to enable us to understand such biological systems as a basis for food safety, we have to develop powerful metabolomics-based approaches to reveal actually those metabolites which are key in food crops. So you end up actually with very specific and very complex spectrum obtained by mass spectrometry. And it is actually the big art of bioinformaticians to get the relevant information out of it. So each of these peaks indicating metabolites which can be of importance to food safety on the one hand, but also to, for instance, resistant genotypes and properties on the other hand. And this is actually linking this metabolomics approach in an effort to detect and to quantify all the mycotoxins and all the secondary metabolites which are there in an entire biological system, to link actually these to the genes, or at least to certain parts of, as indicated here, to a wheat chromosome, and to know which genes are actually responsible for the production of which contaminant or which metabolite, which is important for some resistant properties. And such a system should ideally be a very important component of any integrated approach, as for instance my toolbox, which is a new project which is coordinated by myself, where actually pre-harvest techniques with early indicators on the field, also cultural protocols combined with post-harvest strategies to monitor actually storages with molds and mycotoxins as to find parameters as early indicators for the production of such molds. Also to include safe use options of contaminated batches. Actually, we have on the one hand, we are growing grains to produce bioethanol, but on the other hand, we have to throw away millions of tons of mycotoxin contaminated grain. So why not taking advantage of contaminated grains and to produce biofuels out of these mycotoxin contaminated grains by utilizing a new generation of enzymes which actually promote this fermentation and also degrade mycotoxin during the fermentation procedure. So ideally, such measures feed into web-based tools which inform the crop managers, but also food managers, and also getting the loop back from the industry also providing us with new strategies, new thermal processing, new baking strategies, also sorting techniques of, for instance, contaminated figs in order to reduce any natural contaminants, and also to anticipate standards and legal
settings and regulatory issues. So these are actually so-called integrated multi-actor-based approaches, and I think that the European Commission has made a very wise decision to kind of demand researchers and to force them to collaborate with the industry and with actually interdisciplinary partners and not just to look for the old friends. And that is actually being done in our project, My Toolbox, with about 23 partners, three actually from China and more than 40% industry participation. And with that, I would like to conclude that under extreme weather conditions like heat, drought, etc., fungal diseases on the one hand, but also algal blooms become increasingly unpredictable. There is an increasing need for this so-called multi-toxin testing to check actually for a wide spectrum of contaminants in the entire food and feed chain. We also have to understand the entire biological system through novel so-called omics approaches as a basis for reducing such contaminants in food crops. And finally, I would like to point out the need for integrated approaches actually be going beyond the, well, in the meanwhile, usual fields to fork approach, also including starting actually with smart breeding, but also including waste management procedures with biofuel productions as presented before. With that, thanks for your attention and well, that's it.
Thank you, Professor Krishka, for highlighting how a powerful initiative can address some of these challenges from a research standpoint. And with that, we're going to shift gears, in fact, to an industry perspective, and starting with Dr. Vittorio Zambrini from Granarolo, who's going to give us his perspective. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for inviting me. My presentation will be a little bit different. That means I will make a first review of some reflection that has been already made this afternoon and this morning. That means our reflection based on questions and say, okay, which are the challenges we have seen. We are almost frightened of the perspective of the future in terms of quality of life, and it's clear that we, if we don't act, we will have a real problem. So, as a matter of fact, in terms of main challenges for research and innovation, of course, first of all, no water and no energy, no party. No. So it is especially in developing countries, if you don't have a source of clean potable water and of energy, you can't build up anything at all. Of course, as we have seen, we need to have a selection of more climate resilient and sustainable crops, but not only crops, I'm speaking of the livestock as well, because of course when you go in some hot countries, the milk production per capita is very low. It's one third than what we are used to see in Europe or in the States or in New Zealand, of course. So there as well, a genetic selection of the cows is very much needed in order to increase the productivity. But if we go in some African countries, of course, you have, first of all, to create the basis for the feeding the animals. This is another really important point. Of course, I will skip because there are too many, but I want to underline once again the point of innovative education programs. That means we need to educate consumers. We have seen we probably in the future we'll have to change our eating habits and to understand well how to eat better and healthy. And on the other side, we need to train the food operator operators in order to increase at maximum their professional competencies. The second point was about the best practice. Of course, we need to have an integrated approach to research, education and innovation in the agri-food sector if you want to face the challenges. And this is, as we have seen, is are the basis, for example, for the European KIC principles. Funding, it is an important point, of course, public-private research and innovation. We must be very concrete. That means that we need to have pilot projects that for growth. That means not only at the proof of concept, that means in the beginning, but to see the reality of some application and of the results that we can get. Of course, networking also in terms of competencies and center of research and innovation, the existing but also in the developing countries, favoring networking, this is very important. And the other point is to facilitate all those food programs, including the fact this is really co-construction, and it's not simply transfer, to have perennial results. And I want to show you a couple of things that we made. This is one thing that we made in the past in Tanzania, for example, African Milk Project. This led to the construction of a dairy and support to the farmers in order to create a milk supply chain. Also, we must think that in these countries, milk is not so much consumed. So we made also a program to give pasteurized milk to the children, 25,000 children in the school, free of charge, in order to increase the milk consumption. As a matter of fact, we installed the same model that we have in Italy with the cooperative of the farmers behind and the industry to transform milk in products and sell it to the market. The same was made in Tanzania. And now this project ended up last year, and now it's going on. We are still there helping a little bit, but it is a way of co-constructing something. And this year we are starting with a new project, this one of that we have received, that is in Mozambique. And this will have the support of the region, Emilia-Romagna, of the deputy Cecil Kienge. As you can see, the Reggio Emilia, Copermondo, Federuna Coma, Granarolo, and Cefa Onlus as well. It means trying to do the same. It means to improve the productivity and to teach also the dairy to make good and safe food for the people, and there as well, because malnutrition is present in wide countries in Africa. There again, milk can be a very good source of nutrients in order to improve their nutrition status. Again, to a couple of slides. How to innovate the dialogue among the regional, national, and global players. Once again, think global, act local. So we should try to find out some organization, because we need a new way of doing things, of course, and collaboration, mutual learning, no doubt, and thinking of something like the living labs. There are structure to improve innovation that listen to the consumer needs and try to innovate all together. This could be something very useful, I suppose. And of course, government, public, private organizations should join I would say, think tank tables at all levels in order to say, okay, let's propose something new and let's propose a practical project in order to achieve tangible results in a short time. Last but not least, about global and local trends involving all the key players. We have seen we need to involve all of us if we want to face this challenge that is really incredible in dimensions. And the basic principles are the ones that we have heard before, so nothing new. Then I would like to, if you want to speak a little bit of innovation in dairy, is something that is not so easy. No? So, but I want to spend a couple of words about milk proteins that, as a matter of fact, are the base of all milk and dairy products, and are so very important from a technological point of view, but also from a nutritional and functional point of view. And in Italy, unfortunately, the people speak not so much of protein, on the importance of protein. In the presentation before, we saw the importance of the nitrogen balance, so that means we need sources, even new sources of proteins for the future. Of course, milk is there, and the proteins from milk are very interesting and very nutritious. As a matter of fact, here you have the composition of milk of some species. As you can see, there are more than 4,000 mammals in this world. The analysis that we are available are only for 180, but only 50 are on 50 species are reliable. And milk is a staple food, complex, variable, but very flexible raw material. Think only from the same milk how many products you can get. And of course, it is an important source of high-value nutrients, notably of proteins. When we speak of proteins, of course, we have a large differences between interspecies, from 1% in human milk for more than 20% in small mammals. And there is a good correlation between the protein content of milk and the growth rate of the neonate of that species. So the small mammals that have high the domestic rabbit, 9-10% of protein, of casein in this case, but there they grow very fast, whereas for the human being, only 1% is enough. The protein in milk are of the two types, caseins and whey proteins. And approximately 80% of the total nitrogen in bovine, ovine, caprine, and buffalo milks, there are those that are normally used in human nutrition, is casein. So 20% is whey proteins, whereas in the human milk, casein is only 40%, and whey proteins are 60%. When we speak about casein, we must take into consideration that we have at least four types, alpha S1, alpha S2, beta, and K casein. We have also gamma casein. Casein are small molecules, as such, some 25 kilodaltons. Typically, they are phosphorylated, so all of them, you can see there the quantity of phosphate that are phosphorylated, and this gives a strong capacity of link cations, which would lead these proteins to precipitate, because for calcium concentration higher of 6 millimolar, it gets down. But the point is that thanks to the K casein, there is a highly glycosylated, takes an ultrastructure that is called submicels, and finally the submicels are linked together to give this hairy complex which are the casein micelles. It's hairy because these are the glycosylated ends of the K casein, which are hydrophilic, whereas all the rest is inside because it is low hydrophilic. One strong characteristic is the high level of proline, and this amino acid prevents the formation of secondary structure like alpha helices or beta sheet. So this means that the casein have a very flexible structures, which has been described as rheomorphic. Whey proteins, on the other side, there are at least four types, alpha-lactalbumin, beta-lactoglobulin, BSA, and immunoglobulins. They are typical globular proteins. They are not phosphorylated at all, and so they are completely unsensitivity to calcium, and they are typically denatured upon heating. Milk contains also a lot of other minor proteins that accounts for the rest of the 10% of the sum, and you can see enzymes or other products. In their importance in health and nutrition, in composition, you see you have there all the fractions, and you see a richness in lysine, for example, cysteine only for the whey proteins, and the richness in proline, as we have seen before. The FAO in 2014 changed the evaluation system from PDCAS to DIAAS. So, and in order to evaluate better evaluate the biological value of milk proteins, as you can see on the right, you can see that milk protein concentrate or whey protein isolate or whey protein concentrate are very high. Then you have the soy protein, and finally on the right the pea protein concentrate. So milk proteins are proteins of higher value when compared to other protein sources. What about their functional effects? This is, for example, observational studies that have been made on children, for example, associating consumption of milk to body mass. So the risk, as you know, the overweight and obesity are two big topics. In Italy, for example, more than 50% of the population is overweight. And if you go to the children, they are in the same situation. Well, here you can see from a large population of children that if you drink more than two portions of milk a day, you have a reduced risk of having overweight. Okay. This is statistically significant, but not only on children. This is a longitudinal study that was made on U.S. women, normal weight, that shows that those who have a dairy intake higher develop weight, yes, but less than the women that consume less milk. Also, dietary calcium intake and body fat in young healthy adults have an effect, as you can see on the left side. The dairy calcium intake gives a significantly lower fat mass in these people. Very important the effect of whey protein. Whey protein are able to evitate hunger. 1 minute, yes, I will go very fast. I will end up with the whey proteins. That means this is an acute test where two consumers, you give a preload of water or of increasing quantity of whey proteins. Then you wait 30 minutes and you say to them, okay, now you can eat pizza meal as much as you want. And what you obtain, that those who ate the whey proteins eat less pizza. So, and you have a caloric compensation, so you eat 50% less than with water. Whey protein has an effect also on insulin level and insulin resistance. As you can see, this on 12 weeks, 27 grams a day of whey protein. That means a bowl of ricotta every day, for example. And you can see that after 12 weeks, the whey proteins give a lower quantity of insulin. And also, on the right, you have an index of the resistance. So a lower resistance, so a better functionality and activity. This is the last one, and I say that whey proteins, as a matter of fact, reduces short-term food intake relative to placebo, carbohydrate or other proteins. They affect satiation and satiety by the action of whey protein themselves, bioactive peptides, amino acids, and the combined action of the whole. The ingestion of whey proteins activate many components of the food intake regulatory system, and whey protein is as well insulinotropic, and whey-borne peptides affect the renin angiotensin system, so this means lower the risk for diabetes. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much for these insights. Thank you. And I guess last but not least, we're going to have Dr. Michael Backer from Global Food Services in Google speaking to us about changes in food trends and demands and future developments in this area.
Thank you. So good evening. I have the pleasure to be probably one of the last speakers and try to keep you actually engaged until we're done. So my perspective this evening is probably very different from the perspectives you've heard so far today. I'm not a researcher, I'm not a scientist, I'm an operator. So my name is Michael Backer, and I'm the global leader of Google's food program. Our program is responsible for feeding anybody who works in the Google environment anywhere around the world. We are very intentional about what we do with food, and we're a large global organization. We're now in 56 countries as of today, and we're feeding over 90,000 people on a regular basis. And the reason why we continue to invest in food in the way we do is because we have four broad objectives with our program. We truly believe as an organization that food has a tremendous impact on the health and well-being, of an individual, both short as well as long term. The second reason is that we believe that food has a tremendous culture on our impact on our culture and our work dynamics. We believe as well that we can use our food ecosystem to support different teams at Google. And then last but not least, we clearly use our program as well to attract and to retain top talent around the world. And the way how we look at food is probably, in our world, very innovative. We are a mission-driven organization. So we truly believe that with our program, we can inspire and enable the Google community to make food choices, to enjoy food experiences, and actually help them to make those food choices and enjoy food experiences that support them in being their best. So our goal is not really to tell them what to eat, but first and foremost, it is about to engage, to energize, and to enable them with food. The core question for our program is, how can we help people to be at their best, both short as well as long term, through food experiences? It is not just food, it's food experiences. And our challenge these days is how can we enable individuals to make personal food choices for sustainable lifestyles. So sustainable both from a personal health and well-being perspective, and sustainable from an environmental perspective. So as you can imagine, as I work at Google, DNA is at the core of what we do. So the question to be discussed this evening is, what might be innovation opportunities in the food and food ecosystems? And I think before we can answer that question, it is really about what are the threats, needs, and opportunities. So what you see over here is actually a map about future opportunities, the seeds of disruption, developed by the Institute for the Future with the Future Food Institute. One way of looking at what needs to be addressed going forward that requires innovation. And when you think about innovation, the question is, from what perspective? Are you trying to address something on a global level, on a regional, national, or local level? Then you get the question about the time frame as well. Is it about something you want to address today, or are you trying to innovate something to be prepared for what may be coming our way in 2050? And when you talk about food, there's an interesting question to be posed as well. Are we just talking about food, or is it food, feed, and fuel? They're probably very interrelated. And then last but not least, when you try to look at solutions, what paradigm do you believe in? Is it just a matter of, can we jointly produce more food? Will actually technology and life sciences be the solution for all our challenges we're facing today and in the future? Or does it really require a much more ecological perspective? And if you think about the global food system challenges, they're broad and they're acute. And probably throughout the day today, you've heard various interpretations and various viewpoints of what needs to be addressed today and over the long haul in order to be able to feed 9 billion people by 2050. So when you think about the future, some of us might think that this will be the solution or part of the solution. Others might say, me included, that there are probably multiple solutions for whatever is coming our way. And I would argue as well that to an extent, in the future, we can go back to the future. What you have over in Italy is something to be incredibly proud of, but probably what needs to be changed is the way how you would actually distribute your products outside of Italy, as well as how you would talk about your products, because just having great products and great local food systems is not necessarily sufficient to help you with the broader food system challenges. And then your question as well, what are consumers looking at? So as you can imagine, in our environment, there's quite a bit of data available. And with Think with Google, which is a publicly accessible website, we publish actually trends as well that we see based on what users are searching on Google Search. And what we published just a week ago are the 2016 food trends on Google. Six interesting trends based on actually what users, consumers are searching for on Google over the last couple of years. Publicly accessible. And at the same time, I really believe that you have to think in big, hairy, audacious goals. So for example, to give you an example. So a couple of years ago, our organization was thinking through, how can we provide internet access to very remote areas? The solution to that for us has been bringing internet access with actually balloons. 3 years ago, we'd have said that is absolutely crazy, that will never work. But as of today, balloons are flying around in, for example, New Zealand, where we're bringing internet access to very remote areas. And I think the same type of paradigm shift can be applied to our industry as well. So sometimes the craziest ideas might actually be the ideas that are going to help us. In my own ecosystem, Google Food, not Google, I'm actually very interested in areas you see over here. I'm very interested with our broader team to think through personalized food experiences and nutritions. Food literacy, how can we help the next generation to become truly food literate again and getting them to understand where food is coming from and how you actually cook a meal. Consumer behavior and food choices. A balanced plant-centric or plant-forward diet. Thinking about the future of smart kitchens, which can be both professional kitchens as well as consumer kitchens. the broad term food innovation, and last but not least, food care. There is a tremendous relationship between actually what you eat and healthcare. And how can we think much more holistically about food care versus just thinking about those two elements separately? And in our world, in which actually innovation is constantly around us, sometimes it's not about innovation, but sometimes it's about consumer behavior. So a big driver of change in my ecosystem is actually applying behavioral economics, behavioral sciences, and making the best choice the easiest choice. And really thinking through that, applying behavioral sciences, applying retail 101 to help our users, the consumer, to make better food choices. It truly, truly works. But when I think about possible solutions for the future as well, it is not just thinking about the next solution. I personally believe that many of the solutions we're looking for are already here. It is not about getting more data or figuring out the best possible solution. I think a big part of what is ahead of us is to think through what is blocking us from implementing the solutions that we are already familiar with as of today. It's just as well as thinking through who are the change makers. Who is it that a consumer nowadays trusts? Quite often, it is no longer the large corporation, and it's not necessarily the governments. But you get this interesting, actually, challenge is that we trust our friends more than we trust the traditional organizations. And how do we deal with that? Last but not least, in our organization, it's all about launching and iterating. We're totally okay with actually launching something today and making it better based on what we've learned. So taking on failure. And then think about actually the culinary world as well, in the words of Julia Childs. The only real stumbling block is the fear of failure. In cooking, you have to got to have a what the hell attitude. Or if you think about Thomas Edison, I haven't failed. I've just found 10,000 ways that won't work. Last but not least, when I think about food, I really think about the culture of food, the impact that food can make. It's not necessarily about the functionality of food or really thinking through how can you optimize it. It is really going back to what has brought us together, the culture and the joy of food. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for highlighting that, I guess, failure, fear and crazy are not words in the dictionary of innovation and research. And I think that's a great note to end with. Unfortunately, we won't have enough time to have a discussion or to have questions with our speakers. I would like to ask you to join me with a round of applause for our speakers and experts for their insights. Thank you very much. And I would like to invite Professor Fava to contribute to ending this session.
Okay. So good afternoon once again. And we have few. The idea was to deliver a few remarks on what came out from the two different sessions. We start with my one, dealing with the research and innovation for Europe. So I think that we can conclude a few words, right? Just summarizing the most relevant outcomes. So my feeling is that the European research and innovation policies and actions have the real potential of improving food security, safety, and sustainability, and to provide high quality jobs and wealth in Europe. So I think we have good actions in place for Europe. Surely we need to better look or look more extensively to at the soils, the soil fertility, but also at the soil ability to fix CO2. This was not mentioned in the talk this morning, but I think we have room for working at the soil microbiome in order to make the soil able to catch CO2, convert into organic matter, so with big advantages, removing CO2, producing organic matter for making the soil more fertile. And we need novel approaches, tools in the food safety domain for facing novel or emerging risk associated with the new products that we are importing, the new technologies that we are using, and the open market in which we are buying new food products. So we need new tools, more sophisticated probably, for monitoring what is the quality of product. For sure, we also need to better integrate, better exploit education, research, and business. This is something which will be done soon with the KIC food, which, as I understood from the talk, the specific talk on this topic, is on the way. We will have a new KIC on this in Europe, of course, in maybe next year, the beginning of next year. For concluding, I think that we need for sure a clearer vision, a clearer leadership. These were the messages that came out from a couple of talks. And after this, with a good vision, leadership, we have to integrate things. We have to integrate expertise at the best competencies that we have, because the approach is always highly interdisciplinary. We have to combine methods and technologies. This is also important because we need an integrated approaches. We need to integrate actors. We need to put together university research centers and industry and public institutions and regulatory bodies and the society. Very relevant, this society, because there are no innovation if the society is not involved in it. But we need all the value chain, if you wish, all the actors all together. And then we need to integrate funds. Funds at the regional, national, European level. Infrastructure at the regional, national, European level. Of course, we need money. But money are already on place. Very often we are using them for duplicating things. We need to put together along the same way the different sorts of money. And for concluding, we need for sure a global view, not only in Europe. We have to have a global view. We need more deeply and carefully look at the international markets. That was the message, and also at the global needs. This is something that we should do more efficiently in the future at the European level. I think to have summarized the major messages came from my session, so I leave, as usual, the floor to my colleague. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Fabio. I guess to build on what Professor Fava has indicated, clearly our experts who have contributed to the global innovation session demonstrated the interdependencies of the various agendas, interdependencies of climate change, of food security, of food safety, impact on crop production, and so on. I think there was a clear demonstration that a food research and innovation agenda can offer opportunities for solutions. In a number of instances, these solutions actually are available and were presented and may require simply a boost. In some other instances, more investment and more resource and mobilization may be required. We had clear statements from the leadership of the region here, of the region of Emilia-Romagna, about their commitment to supporting not only a local and national agenda for research and innovation, but also a global one, being essentially a leader in food production in Italy, in Europe, and in the world. And therefore, a forum such as the World Food Forum could potentially be a contributor for boosting, mobilizing efforts around innovation and research in food, amongst other things, as well as addressing challenges relating to safety, food security, and sustainability. Hopefully, these insights will contribute to shaping the future agenda of this initiative, of this legacy of Expo 2015, and this is what we will discuss with you sometime tomorrow. Thank you again for your contribution to this first day, and we wish you a great evening. Thank you again.
Oh, yeah.